Welcome to the Learn Skin Podcast with Dr. Raja and Dr. Hadar, where they discuss all things skin. Skin is fascinating because it affects us in so many ways, like our health, psychology, and how we connect with those around us. This podcast delves into the art and science of skincare. A short disclaimer before we get to the good stuff. Dr. Raja Sivamani and Dr. Hadar Levtov are board-certified dermatologists. This podcast is meant for educational and informational purposes only. All opinions shared do not express the views of Learn Skin. Neither this podcast nor any information contained within it are a substitute for professional care by a doctor or other qualified medical professional. This podcast does not constitute medical or other professional advice or services.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Learn Skin Podcast. Again, today we have a special guest with us, Trevor Erickson, who is a registered doctor of traditional Chinese medicine in British Columbia. That's in Canada, my friends. And he has been practicing for over 14 years. However, even before that, he did a lot of training in traditional Chinese medicine and focused most of his training on dermatology, allergy, and inflammatory disease. He trained in China and also completed the very distinguished fellowship with Mazen El-Khafaji in London. He is now practicing in Canada, and he's one of the founding board members of the International Chinese Medicine Dermatology Group. So, Trevor, welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Absolutely. And it's great to have you here. And I think this is a great opportunity to have you here because one of the areas that Chinese medicine is specializing in is herbal treatments. And when we think about, at least when I think about integrative medicine and integrative dermatology, the area of herbal remedies is probably, to me, is the most provoking. I think about this as an area that has a lot of potential for research and discovery of new treatments. So we wanted to have you help us and maybe guide us with a little introductory content on how herbalism work in traditional Chinese medicine. Does that sound good?
That sounds fantastic. I'd love to have the conversation. Absolutely.
All right. Excellent. So let's dive into it because I know that I learned from you and from Mazen and from other practitioners that when it comes to herbal medication, it is very important to select the medicine based on the patient's individual needs and not just the disease itself. Can you elaborate about that a little bit?
You know, absolutely. I mean, in Chinese medicine, you know, we typically say there's different layers to the diagnosis. So the first step is going to be the diagnosis of the disease. And that's very important, just like in Western medicine. So someone's going to, if it's, say it's dermatology, they come into the office and they have a red and flaky lesion on their body. We're going to look at it and we're going to try to figure out what it is. And then that's very important. So is it psoriasis? Is it a type of tinea? Is it eczema? What is this thing? And then from there, we're going to make some decisions about treatment. And in Chinese medicine, we are going to go a little bit deeper into that. So let's say it's psoriasis or even eczema. So what we're going to want to know, we're going to learn a lot about the individual look of how is this disease manifesting in this person in this given moment in time. So let's say it's a palmplex eczema flare. Okay, are they in full-on tons of blistering going on in their palms and itchy and maybe there's some exudate or some liquid coming out? Or are they in the other stage where it's just dry and cracked and maybe some scaling but not a lot of blister activity? So the actual manifestation of the disease, how intense it is, how big it is, how widespread it is, how long have they had it, what does it actually look like, is it dry, damp, all these things are going to be very important in choosing the right herbal medicines to fit the bill, to match that, right? So there's not just one, you know, set formula for eczema or one set formula for acne or one set formula for asthma or whatever it is. So it's going to really depend on how they're manifesting that disease at any given moment in time. And then as well, what is their digestive state like? How is their sleeping? Do they sweat a lot? Are they really thirsty or do they not thirsty? Do their urine burning when they pee? They have headaches, all these other factors. Is it really itchy or not itchy at all? A lot of these factors are then going to go into that kind of pot. And what we're going to do is come out, we're going to create it's like a puzzle where all these pieces are coming together. And we call this pattern differentiation, and where we're taking as much information as we can about the patient, their general health, as well as the particular disease that they suffer with. And then in this given moment in time, And then we're going to create a herbal formula that matches that presentation. And that's a very old method, you know, right back from our earliest textbooks and, you know, written in the, you know, 200 BC or thereabouts.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of sayings that we have, but it kind of evolved into this, we call Yi Bong Tongjer, Tong Bing Yijer, which means different diseases, same treatment, same disease, different treatments. So it's this idea of—
That's great. That's wonderful.
Know, individualizing, which is very important. Yeah, and then we look at these various things about the treatment of a disease. And there was a lot of, around the Song Dynasty, 1100 BC, there were the Chinese government, you know, the emperor at the time, they regulated herbal pharmacies. They created state-owned pharmacies. And through that, for many reasons, one was to stop the sale of fake medicines, you know, to make sure that charlatans weren't marking up medicine during times of crisis, like, or epidemics. So if there was a herb known to treat a particular epidemic, they wouldn't mark it up it to unreasonable levels for the normal person to be able to afford. So they had some really good ethics around regulating these pharmacies. But they also realized that it started to make a lot of money. And so they started to make these standardized herbal formulas that they could sell to the general public. And they were kind of the, you know, herbal pills. And so they started to do it to bypass the doctor so that a patient could go directly to the herb shop and look at, they just go, oh, I have this disease. Oh, I could take this pill, you know, that's already pre-made, take it home and try it. And there was a lot of flack from the medical community saying, well, that's very dangerous. You know, it's not individualized enough. And so a lot of people really, you know, fought against that, this idea that no, medicine should be individualized. It should be based on how the patient's presenting, not just one disease, one treatment kind of idea. So a long history there. I think it's very good.
Thank you, Trevor. That was a wonderful overview. And I cannot resist to point out some of the similarities to in so many different aspects, right? Talking about the need for one fix, one quick fix, just move across and pass the doctor and just go straight to the pharmacy. We see this right now, actually, in Western medicine, all across people going to this doc-in-a-box kind of stores, mm-hmm. and especially in specialized fields like dermatology. Right. It is very, very difficult. And I think that you are absolutely right, because I think a lot of people, a lot of companies have tried to put Chinese medicine into a capsule and tried to promote it, or into a jar in our case.
For sure. Absolutely. Right? Yeah. It makes a lot of financial sense to the person who tries, but it's kind of like Russian roulette, right? It might work sometimes, but it's going to be a lot of the time it doesn't work, or it might actually make things worse.
And it's actually a challenge when you try to study Chinese medicine because of that very specific tailoring of medication to the patient's need. It is very difficult to do a randomized controlled trial where that by design is trying to find the mean effect across a population. So when you have it so specialized, sometimes it's very hard to do. The other thing I've noticed about when you were talking about identifying the pattern, the specific pattern in time, talking about eczematous eruptions, about the acute, the subacute, and the chronic, I think a lot of dermatologists who may be listening who've been trained in Western medicine will definitely identify with this recognition of the pattern and the need to adjust your management to that. What I thought was interesting, though, is the pattern of systemic disease as well, which I think Western medicine falls short in identifying a whole pattern and how the skin sometimes can be a manifestation of systemic disease, which we certainly see, but identifying these global patterns is sometimes challenging for the Western clinicians. So certainly a lot of back and forth between the traditions, I think, is really useful.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you for that. One of the other questions I had for you, speaking about herbal medicines and how to approach the patient in front of you, is how do you generally categorize herbal medicines in Chinese medicine? If you can give us, I would say in a nutshell, if you could.
Sure. I mean, it's a big topic and years of study, of course. But, you know, herbal medicines over time, first off, herbal medicine has been written about for a long time. We have references to herbal medicines from some of the earliest records in China, you know, and very exciting stuff, like when they unload you know, a tomb dig, for instance, in where I trained in Hunan province, there's a very famous tomb called the Ma Wang Dui tomb, which was, you know, buried in about 300 BC and uncovered in the 1970s. And it was, everything in it was just in perfect condition, including like herbal medicines that had been stored, scrolls about medicine, scrolls about astronomy, things like, you know, the earth revolving around the sun every 365 days and stuff like this, way before Galileo's time. And there's a book in there called the book, I think it's called the Book of 52 Recipes, something like that. And it's mostly about skin disease, because that, I mean, that's what most people see, is they come in and they have all these sores or wounds on them.
Huh. And fascinating, right? Skin disease is so central to treatment.
I mean, we know in China that back from Confucius times, right around that same time, 300 BC, dermatology was already a regulated specialty. So you'd go to a GP, the GP would look at you and be like, oh no, I think you need to go see this skin doctor, this dermatologist. And then even, you know, within dermatology, there were specialists, like people that were good at arrow wounds, say, or people that were good at, say, inflammatory disease or something like that. So they're very highly specialized. And that continued right up to this present day. But in this medical book they found in the Ma Wang Dui tomb, it actually has reference to one of the earliest herbal formulas ever in the world, I think. And it's basically seven different herbs mixed together, and for the treatment of a type of abscess. And it even shows how to adjust the individual ingredients in that prescription depending on what is happening. If the abscess isn't healing properly, or if it's really aggressive, these kind of things. So it's really fascinating. But back in those days, they didn't have a real good system of categorizing the medicines. It wasn't until later in history, you know, maybe medieval times in China, they started to really categorize herbs based on their actions. So, you know, looking at, okay, what is this herb doing to the body? What is its main function? What is its main action? And then they started to categorize the herbs. And I think I have in here maybe some examples of that. You know, they look at things like, you know, herbs that promote sweating, say, or we call release the exterior, or herbs that purge to let out, you know, bowel movements as a way to get rid of whatever toxicity or buildup of inflammation in the body, promoting urination or promoting circulation of blood or building up the body, say in anemic or cases of a lot of dryness, like, you know, herbs that could tonify the blood and moisten the body, like using a moisturizer from the inside out, right? And all these kind of concepts. So when we diagnose a patient and we come up with these patterns, so we look at, okay, they have this problem going on, this disease, this is how it's manifesting, and they have all these general health complaints. We come up with a pattern, and then, or many, multiple patterns, and then we're going to choose herbs according to those patterns. So if they're, you know, if they're really red in the face and hot and thirsty and they're very constipated and they're lucky to have a bowel movement every 3 days that's very dry and hard, and they also have these bright red, you know, itchy lesions on their body, well, we know for sure we have to purge their bowels. We've got to get their bowels moving as a way to get things moving along. And then, so, you know, in a very simple nutshell case, you know, it's kind of like that. So first we get the pattern, the individualized idea, picture of this person. What's the disease they're suffering with? How is that disease manifesting in this given moment in time? And then, you know, what are the underlying systemic general health issues going on with them? And then all of that goes together. And from that, we have categories of herbs that kind of match those patterns. And then we can create a formula and go with that. So it's quite a scientific and elaborate system, and as well as quite primitive. It's been used for a long, long time and been more and more sophisticated over time.
Well, mission accomplished, Trevor. You were able to help us go through the categories and kind of understand the approach. So thank you. I thought it would be an impossible mission, but you did it great. Thank you so much. Because maybe our listeners, I know myself, it takes some time to understand and get a sense of how a Chinese medicine practitioner approaches disease in general. So that was very, very useful. And I must say, every time we speak, I'm so fascinated by the depth of your knowledge about Chinese medicine and your ability to go through these texts. I must say I'm a little envious. So, but you know, one of the questions I always had is about when we use herbal medicines, there seemed to be a preference to use raw medicines, raw herbals. And can you elaborate about why that is important to you when you try to treat a patient?
For sure, absolutely. So herbal medicine, first off, in Chinese medicine, is usually always a prescription. There's always a mixture of medicines. It's rarely ever what we call mono pharmacy. It's usually a polypharmacy. There's many different ingredients being mixed together and creating this kind of prescription. And that idea is very old. I talked about this prescription of seven herbs from like 300 BC, this idea of mixing these herbs and then changing the individual ingredients within that prescription to match whatever's happening in the patient. So some very special things happen there. So for one thing, this prescription, when we take those herbs and we make a prescription based on the patient, and then we take those herbs and cook them in water, that process we call tang. Tang means soup. It's actually, we're making a soup for the patient, right?
Delicious.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, delicious. I tell all my patients, this is going to be very delicious. So a herbal soup. So we all know what happens when you create a soup. If you cook a soup, there's a big difference between just mixing a bunch of ingredients and throwing in a pot of water and then eating it right away or drinking it right away. I mean, it might taste terrible, unsynchronized, it's not going to have much effect. But if you take those ingredients and you cook them together over a period of time, what's going to happen is this chili or soup or whatever it is you're making, this curry dish or whatever, it's going to get more delicious. And what is happening is these ingredients are synergizing with each other. They're blending together. And this idea of the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. There's new things being formed in this blend. So that the idea, this very old idea in Chinese medicine, is you take these raw herbs that are, you know, whatever, sticks and seeds and roots and flowers, fruits, and you take water and you heat that water and thyme. And what happens is the water and heat extract chemicals out of these plants. And then these chemicals become, you know, soluble in the water. And then through the process of heat, they combine with other chemicals in the other plants, and new chemical bonds are formed, such that this idea that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts. And so there's a very famous thing in China of understanding what herbs go together, or the herb combining idea. Like if I mix this herb with this herb, you're going to get a better effect if I just use this herb alone. And now they've done modern studies where they cook one herb, like a traditional pear, and they'll cook it, this traditional pear together, and they notice that one of the chemicals is extracted in a much larger percentage than otherwise. But if they take this same plant, like say blueperium, and they mix it with a different herb and cook it, a totally different chemical that comes out of the mix. So there's this pulling and creation of new chemicals that are created, and that doesn't happen otherwise. If so, people sometimes use herbal powders or capsules or tablets and these things where things don't go through this cooking process, then these chemical bonds aren't being created, and they're not getting the best bang for their buck. And as well, it's not individualized. They're not able to take these individual mix of herbs, cook them together, and create something very unique and individual for the patient. So this idea is very old, and I think gives the practitioner, the physician, much more freedom to be really elaborate with the prescription for their patient. If they have to rely on things that are already pre-made or powders that aren't cooked together, they're very limited in what they can do. And there's this idea in Chinese medicine that I think a lot about, is there's kind of three main components to a successful treatment. One is the patient. Does the patient have something that is even treatable? You know, so for instance, people coming to me, if they have, you know, say actinic keratosis, I don't feel like I have a good treatment for that. So I'll often just say, look, you might be better off seeing your Western dermatologist. I don't really have something good, or maybe try that what do they call that, Curaderm with the eggplant extract or something. But me personally, in my own clinical practice, I don't. So the first step is, does the patient have anything? Does the patient presenting with something that is actually treatable with my medicine? So if they do, then the second step is, okay, well, does the doctor have enough training and proper experience to actually treat it? Okay, so patient might have something very treatable, but the doctor lacks skill. They don't know what they're doing, lack experience or proper training. So the last one is going to be the treatment itself. So the patient can have something very treatable, like Pomflex eczema is very treatable with herbal medicine. And with good skill, can come up with a good theory and plan and create a perfect prescription to treat this Pomflex eczema. But if they're using inferior medicines, if they're not using medicine that is proper, they might not get a good effect. And so that's why I like, you go to the best, you get as high quality raw herbal medicines that are fresh. They have a lot of these chemical constituents still inside them. Cook it fresh, and then they can get the best bang for their buck. So I'm a big believer in to really to replicate that as much as possible.
Yes, thank you for that. And also, I think it helps when you actually understand the source of these herbals, where they came from, when you use raw plants. Is that true? Do you find that to be true?
I do find that to be true. I mean, you know, from talking to people who have, say, been expert witnesses in, you know, herbal toxicity cases, you know, when, say, a patient takes some medicine and they get sick, and then they have a whole kind of analysis, okay, what happened? You know, it's my understanding, a lot of the time, it's pre-prepared medicine. So whenever there's a herbal pill or powder or something, you don't know what really is in there. You don't know if it's been adulterated or been mixed with things that shouldn't be in there. And so I think in many, or if they've used the right species of herb, you know, what all these, there's so many factors that could happen when we're using the raw and we have a good ability to identify those herbs, or we use reliable sources to get the herbs, then we can minimize a lot of that. And I think it becomes quite safe.
And thank you also for mentioning the idea of training and the experience of the clinician, especially in the context of an adverse event that can certainly happen. It happens in Western medicine every day.
Definitely.
And so I find in my practice that the challenge a lot of times is not necessarily treating the disease, but treating the side effect and making sure that you're comfortable with the treatments that you are prescribing. So if something goes wrong, then you can handle it. I always say, you know, going full circle to our initial discussion, is if it was just a diagnosis, match a treatment, any monkey can do it, right?
It's true. Absolutely.
But it's the training, it's that experience that you are looking for in any clinician that
understands
the disease process, understands the medications that are being prescribed, and then understands if something goes wrong, because that's when you want someone with experience. And certainly, Trevor, you have demonstrated to me, at least again and again, your absolute level of expertise, and it's always a pleasure to speak with you. But this is not over, even though we want to finish here, but we will have you at the Integrative Dermatology Symposium. I'm very excited to hear your talk that specifically talks about traditional Chinese medicine approach to topical steroid withdrawal and the red skin syndrome. So that is a loaded topic, and I'm sure we'll have a great discussion. I can't wait for that. And with that, I will thank you for your time. Thank you so much for keeping us educated about Chinese medicine.
You're welcome, Hadar. It was a pleasure, definitely, as always.
Thank you for tuning into the Learn Skin podcast with Dr. Raja and Dr. Hadar. We would like to take this moment to tell you about our upcoming second annual Integrative Dermatology Symposium to be held at the Coronado Island Marriott in San Diego, California. This program is an educational experience jam-packed with information, including case-based discussions and multiple perspectives on topics such as psoriasis, atopic dermatitis, diet and skin microbiome, cannabinoids, hair loss, traditional Chinese medicine, and much, much more. Go to www.integrativedermatologysymposium.com and register today. We look forward to seeing you there.